Welcome to another episode of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we discuss the basins made by the secondary impacts of glacier ice ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. The Carolina Bays originated as inclined conical cavities, so generally they have a mathematically elliptical geometry. The shape of the bay may be modified by the conditions of the terrain at the time of emplacement, or it may be modified later by erosive processes or ground movement. This presentation discusses the mechanism of formation of the almond-shaped bays near Wilson, South Carolina. This is a LiDAR image of the terrain surrounding Bennett's Bay, which is located about 2 miles southeast of Wilson, South Carolina. Bennett's Bay is one of the few large, intact bays remaining in South Carolina. It was previously known as Junkyard Bay, which is how it appears in USGS topographic maps, but today it is part of Bennett's Bay Heritage Preserve. Wilson, South Carolina is an unincorporated community in Clarendon County, located about 60 miles from the Atlantic Ocean along U.S. Route 521. The community is named after Thomas Wilson, a Scotsman who built a sawmill called Wilson's Mill in the area during the late 19th century. Wilson was a bustling logging town with a railroad line in the 1880s, but by 1891, the supply of trees for timber in the area was exhausted and Wilson closed the mill and moved away. The community turned to agriculture, with tobacco being the most profitable crop. Today, farming continues to be Wilson's main activity. Wilson's post office, which started operation in 1888, was officially closed in 1982. The boom and bust of Wilson is an example of what happens from non-sustainable exploitation of renewable natural resources. According to the glacier ice impact hypothesis, the Carolina Bays originated as inclined conical cavities from the secondary impacts of glacier ice chunks, so we expect them to have an elliptical shape. However, these bays are almond-shaped. Why is that? What are the mechanisms that deform the bays in this manner? The answer to these questions can be found by examining the terrain carefully and by using a physical model to simulate the conditions that form these bays. Before we get into the technical analysis of the geomorphology, I want to point out that the Bennett's Bay Heritage Preserve was established because many Carolina bays have disappeared due to the desire to develop additional land. The bays are being logged, cleared, plowed, sliced up by roads, and urbanized at a very fast rate. A 1991 survey by the South Carolina Wildlife and Marine Resources Department identified 2,651 bays in the state with over 2 acres in area, but the survey estimated that only 36 bays are still relatively untouched. That is only 1.3%. Bennett's Bay is being preserved so that future generations will be able to continue to enjoy these unique elliptical-shaped botanical treasure houses and continue the search for their origin. There is a parking area for Bennett's Bay Preserve shown on Google Maps. Using Google Street View, I explored the road next to Bennett's Bay and found that the parking for the preserve was temporarily closed. The preserve, which is on the right side of the road, is a jumble of thick vegetation. Having visited Carolina Bays before, I am sure that there are plenty of snakes, chiggers, and mosquitoes. This is their perfect habitat. A website for Bennett's Bay Heritage Preserve describes a wonderful hiking trail. Enjoy this 1.9-mile loop trail near Manning, South Carolina. Generally considered an easy route, it takes an average of 34 minutes to complete. This trail is great for birding, hiking, and walking, and it's unlikely you'll encounter many other people while exploring. This trail is open year-round and is beautiful to visit anytime. It sure sounds like great fun. I looked at the first 3 reviews of this trail. The first one said, "Unfortunately, this trail is in such bad shape, it's near impassable. I hiked the first half mile in a squishy tilled up road before the trail makes a left into 5 to 6 feet tall grass. If you care to wade through the grass, it's very clearly marked with big reflective signs. Otherwise, it's not worth the drive." The second review said, "Be willing to forge your way through. It's well marked, but not at all well traveled. Conditions? Bridge out, muddy, overgrown, scramble." The third reviewer said, "This trail is very grown over. Hopefully it can get cleared up a bit. But it's pretty much impassable unless you don't mind not knowing if you're about to step on a snake, trip over a root, or step in a hole. I wouldn't recommend this trail right now. Conditions overgrown." So there you have it. In spite of the glorified description of the easy trail in Bennett's Bay, the hikers who got tangled in the bramble gave it just 1.3 stars out of 5. Nothing about the Carolina Bays is easy. Although Bennett's Bay is a nature preserve, the hand of man is evident by the existence of several drainage ditches that cross at various points through the rim of the bay. The LiDAR image shows areas with less vegetation where the water flows, and the inset has a close-up of the channel on the east rim of the bay that drains eastward away from Bennett's Bay. Many bays that are used for agriculture have been drained in this way. There are four remarkable terrain features that characterize Bennett's Bay. The first remarkable feature is the high ridge on the north side of the bay. The interior of Bennett's Bay is at an elevation of 31 meters above sea level, but the north ridge has an elevation of 37 meters. That is a vertical drop of 6 meters. Such sharp margins with precise elliptical shape on a multitude of bays cannot be explained by aeolian and lacustrine processes. The formation of a penetration funnel by an impact process is more likely to create this type of structure. Notice that the high ridge has a ditch that allows water to drain from a small bay at a higher elevation into Bennett's Bay. The second remarkable feature is the incursion of the terrain into the rim of Bennett's Bay on the west side. This is best explained by noting that a small impact basin was created adjacent to the rim of Bennett's Bay. The impact that created the small basin would have pushed the terrain to deform the shape of Bennett's Bay. Here we also see more trenches that drain small bays at higher elevation into Bennett's Bay, which is at a lower elevation. The two other remarkable features of Bennett's Bay are its pointy shape and the overlap with the previously emplaced bay. Later, we will see that the pointy shape is produced by the overhang of a flange of a penetration funnel into the cavity of a previous impact. We can now postulate the sequence of events that produce the landscape of Bennett's Bay. First, an impact created basin number 1. We know this from the law of superposition because basin number 1 is overlaid by Bennett's Bay. Basin number 2 was emplaced after basin 1. We can see that the rim of basin 1 is overlaid by basin 2. The third impact produced Bennett's Bay. It overlaid basin number 1. Notice that the ellipse corresponding to Bennett's Bay has a width of 1,218 meters and a length of 1,912 meters, but the length does not include the pointy shape. The fourth small impact occurred after Bennett's Bay was formed and pushed some material that deformed the rim on the west side of Bennett's Bay. Several other videos have discussed the trajectories of the glacier ice chunks from the impact point on the Laurentide ice sheet. Depending on the launch angle and the distance, the times of flight varied from 6 to 9 minutes after the extraterrestrial impact. This means that all the overlapping impacts in Bennett's Bay area were made within a few seconds of each other. We will now examine the impacts made in the physical model to determine the reason for the almond-like deformation of Bennett's Bay. This image shows an isolated oblique impact of an ice projectile on a viscous surface. In this case, we see the formation of a penetration funnel, which is an inclined conical cavity with flanges that become raised rims around the cavity. When viewed from above, this isolated inclined conical cavity has a mathematically elliptical geometry. This makes sense because ellipses are conic sections. This mathematical precision is indeed what we observe in well-preserved Carolina bays. When we digitize the points along the perimeter of a bay, we can fit an ellipse that passes through these points using a least squares fitting procedure. This image of the physical model shows two adjacent impacts. The first one on the right has a well-formed rim to its right. However, the second one has a stretched flange because the target material did not provide sufficient resistance to constrain the shape. This overhanging flange will give the resulting basin a pointy shape after viscous relaxation. Viscous relaxation is a geological process that tends to level the ground under the force of gravity. Seismic vibrations can increase the rate of viscous relaxation. After viscous relaxation, the depth of the cavity is reduced and the high flanges become raised rims. We can see that when a second impact occurs adjacent to the back of another one, the basin takes an almond shape after viscous relaxation. An ellipse does not fit the shape of the stretched basin. The overhanging flange of the impact becomes a pointy shape in the resulting basin. Looking back at the LiDAR image of Bennett's Bay, we can see the same pattern of one bay made right behind another one. We can now reconstruct the series of impacts that created Bennett's Bay. The first impact created a large inclined conical cavity. The second impact was small and overlaid a portion of basin number 1. The third impact made Bennett's Bay. Based on the physical model, the leading rim of the basin had an overhang that produced a pointy shape. The fourth impact on the west side of Bennett's Bay pushed the rim and created the intrusion that deformed the bay. LIDAR makes it possible to examine the geology of the Carolina Bays in great detail, and hundreds of impacts using the experimental model enable us to deduce the mechanism that formed the features that we see in the LIDAR images. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. I will continue to examine the mechanisms that made the Carolina Bays based on the principles of experimental physics one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.